This is Harsh Rules, I'm Ben Harsh, and today let's continue to learn to play Tide of Iron, the next wave. Tide of Iron is produced by 1A Games and Fantasy Flight Games. This is part two of the series, so if you have started here, you might want to go back and find part one, because there we go through boot camp and we handle all the basics. With that said, our next stop is Officer Candidate School to learn about men and morale. The first thing we're going to learn is how to build squads. There are two types of squads, light squads and heavy squads. Each squad is represented by a squad base that allows you to plug in up to four figures. Light squads are comprised of four individual figures. Heavy squads have at least one crew, that is a figure that takes two posts. These are usually mortar crew or machine gun crew. To keep this tutorial less cluttered, I've created this symbol system that allows us to identify units on a base. The legend on the right identifies every aspect of this new symbol system. There's not a lot of labeling in Tide of Iron to tell you the different unit type. Here's a quick tip to help you differentiate the infantry. The more relaxed a unit is, the more skilled they are. So a regular infantry has his rifle raised to his shoulder. An elite infantry looks like he's shooting from the hip, and the officer has his rifle slung and his hands are down at his sides. Just a quick tip when you have them all plugged into their bases. When dealing with squads, it's also important to consider squad morale. When you make an attack against a squad, you need to decide what type of fire selection you're going to use. You can choose between normal fire, which deals casualties, or suppressive fire. If you score one hit with suppressive fire, the unit is pinned. While pinned, the squad cannot move and they cannot shoot. However, pinned units can be rallied by an officer that enters their hex and allow them to then shoot with 50% firepower. If a squad is hit by suppressive fire three times, they become disrupted. They have the same penalties as pinned, except for now an officer cannot rally them. If a squad is hit with suppressive fire for the fourth time, they become routed and they are immediately removed from the scenario. These effects will last until the end of the game round, so if you're engaging an enemy squad, you need to think carefully about how you want to attack them, either with normal fire and just take casualties, or a suppressive approach and see if you can pin them down or disrupt them. Speaking of officer abilities, officers are critical in Tide of Iron. Let's look at some of the squad dynamics. First of all, whatever squad an officer is in receives an immediate increased mobility bonus of +1 move. This is not a cumulative bonus, so you can't make a squad of four officers that are like the sprinting officers that shoot all around the board. However, the increased mobility is extremely important because you need to be able to change up the hex bonus amongst the different squads on the map. When an officer is in the same hex as other squads, the squads receive three bonuses. The first is fast recovery. During the status phase, this removes all disrupted tokens in a hex. The second is the rally ability. So when you have one of your squads pinned, an officer can allow them to make a 50% firepower shot. Finally, there's determination. While an officer is in a hex, all squads receive +1 cover against suppressive attacks. Determination is not cumulative, so if we have our mythical squad of officers, they will not provide a +4 cover. Having that many egos crammed into a squad also seems like just a really bad idea to me. Anyway, one strategy is to keep your officer nimble so that he can move to different hexes and provide his benefits to other areas that need him. For example, in the illustration, if Squad 1, which has an officer, moves down to the hex with Squad 2 and 3, he can apply his hex bonus there. And while the hex above loses the bonus, let's turn our attention to the elite infantry. These are the battle-hardened veterans who have been through battles and are not easily scared. Each elite infantry in a squad adds +1 cover versus suppressive attacks. This is a cumulative bonus, so the more elite infantry you have in a squad, the stronger they are against suppressive attacks. So if you're fighting a squad with a lot of elites in it, you want to probably just kill them outright because they are not rattled easily by suppressive fire. Another cool feature in Tide of Iron is the ability to conduct squad transfers. And while you can't transfer with a specialized squad, you can use this ability to reinforce weaker squads or move personnel around. So now that we've had a very detailed look at light squads, let's look at heavy infantry squads. Heavy infantry squads contain at least one crew of either a machine gun crew or a mortar crew. Even if there's an officer or an infantry in the same squad as the crew, the squad is still considered heavy. Remember, the squad sticks together. Another important note, even though a crew is composed of two men, it can only take one hit before the whole crew is eliminated. Also, if you activate a heavy infantry squad, there are a few actions you cannot take. You cannot conduct assaults, and you cannot conduct fire and movement. However, despite these penalties, there are other advantages to heavy infantry. In this example, we have a mortar crew attempting to target some Germans on the far side of the map. Now, obviously, mortars are long-range weapons that fire in an arc, so you can't target things adjacent to you. You also need line of sight to fix your coordinates to hit a target. Now, in this example, the mortar crew's line of sight is blocked by a tree line. However, the cool thing about mortars is that line of sight can be provided via radio from another squad that has line of sight to the enemy. The squad can basically radio in the coordinates, and the mortar crew can fire and hit the target. And that's exactly what we have here in this example. Now let's look at the machine gun crew. Machine gun crews are extremely useful because they can be put in rapid op fire. Rapid op fire allows a machine gun crew to shoot at any target that enters its line of fire without fatiguing. So in this example, we have two Germans hiding behind some trees. The minute the first German steps out into the line of sight, the machine gun crew can fire and eliminate him. Because the machine gun crew does not become fatigued, if the other German were to wander into their sights, then they would roll three dice and they would be able to destroy him as well, and so on. Next, we're going to conduct a motor pool inspection. Here in our motor pool, we have all the vehicles from Tide of Iron parked next to each other so we can compare the differences. There are light vehicles and heavy vehicles, just like there are light infantry and heavy infantry. American light vehicles share the same attributes as their German counterparts. Transport trucks do not have any armor and they can't attack, but they can carry two squads. Half tracks are faster and they can conduct some attacks, but they can only carry one squad. Heavy vehicles are tanks, and tanks have a lot of different statistics. In general, most tanks share two special abilities. The first is concussive firepower, which offers a +3 range and a +3 firepower versus squads in buildings or pillboxes. The second is the overrun ability. If a tank plows through the middle of a hex, they can pin enemies at a cost of one movement point to the tank. As far as tanks go, there are basically two types for each side. The M4A1 Sherman for the Americans and the Panzer IV and the Stug III are essentially the same statistics. They're just different to represent historical accuracy. Finally, we have the American M10, which is very similar statistic-wise to the Panzer IV, except that it has some penalties because it's an open-top vehicle. And last but certainly not least is the Tiger I, which has a ridiculous amount of firepower at 13. Each vehicle type has its pros and cons, so use them appropriately. Our officer here doesn't feel like walking, so let's take a vehicle back to the harsh quarters. Boarding and disembarking from vehicles costs movement point. Our officer uses one point to move into the same hex as the truck, and then one point to board the truck. Now, the great thing about vehicle is roads. If there's a road, the vehicle cost for movement is slashed down to one-third. So that means with a movement of four, I can move 12 road hexes. When I arrive at the Harsh Quarters, good old HQ, it costs one movement point to disembark from the truck. It costs one movement point to move into the same hex as the house, and one movement point to enter the house. And if you're wondering about the miles of barbed wire, hedgehogs, and minefields, maybe I'm just a little paranoid. Or maybe I'm just Anyway, let's continue with Officer Candidate School and learn the rules of engagement. In a few minutes, I'll be briefing you on the scenario Clash of Elites, and this is the overall game structure. Clash of Elites is divided into four rounds, and each of those rounds is divided into a number of phases. The first phase in a round is the action phase. Now, part one of the tutorial taught us about the action phase, but here it is in the larger context. In Clash of Elites, there are two actions per turn. So each turn, the Americans get two actions and the Germans get two actions. Based on the available squads to activate, it will take three turns to fatigue all squads. Now let's look at the full menu of actions those squads can take when activated. The new entries to this list from last time is the Assault action, the Fatigue Unit action, and the Activate Strategy Card action. Now, if you don't want to do anything with a unit, you can just fatigue them. If for some reason you don't want to place a unit in Opportunity Fire, you can just fatigue them to end the round. If you want to activate a strategy card, you can use one of your actions to do this. These new additions are all simple, but let's look at the big bad assault action. Assaults are a little complicated, so we're going to walk through one step by step. First of all, to conduct an assault, your active squad will lose one movement point. Then, step one, the active squad will move adjacent to the target hex. Now, before we jump into the thick of it, there are several prohibited assault tactics. You can only use light squads to conduct assaults. You cannot assault a position with heavy armor or concealed units. Pinned and disrupted units cannot support assaults. You cannot assault from a minefield or barbed wire that turn. The next turn, you can assault from that position at a half firepower penalty. Assaults can cause casualties, post-traumatic stress disorder, and sexual dysfunction. Please use only as directed. The active squad is then going to declare an assault with a max of two support squads. So for this assault, squads 2 and 3 to the north are going to assist squad 1. Even though squad 2 is fatigued, it can still provide support in an assault. So then we're going to run our attack equation. Squad 1 is at full power, and they get to use 4 attack dice. Squad 2 and Squad 3 are supporting, so they come in at half power with 2 attack dice each. We roll our 8 dice and we get 5 hits and 3 misses. Remember, an attack at this range we can hit on a 4, a 5, or a 6. Now the Germans are going to calculate their defense equation. So Squad 1 on the German side is entrenched and they get 2 defense dice. The half track does not get any defense dice, even though it's armored. That's the rules. The Germans roll their 2 dices and they miss on both. Now we have 5 solid hits that we add to our assault points. Now we flip the tables and the Germans counterattack and run their attack equation. German Squad 1 is at full power with 4 attack dice, and the half track can attack with 4 attack dice as well. So the Germans roll their 8 dice and they have about my luck and end up only getting 2 hits. Now the Americans have no defense cover to speak of, and there's only infantry in their ranks, so they do not get any defense roll. The Germans get to add 2 hits to their assault points. Next, each side needs to assign the hits of damage to their units. America takes 2 hits to their active squad and removes 2 infantry. The Germans decide to absorb 4 of the hits in their half track, the unit is destroyed, and they take 1 hit to their squad. Now the outcome of the assault is clear. The Americans win with 5 points, and the Germans lose with 2. The Americans can advance and secure the position, and the Germans must retreat. The Germans cannot retreat into the lower hex because it's at max capacity with three other German squads. Apparently, these German squads are just standing around daydreaming about Helga's luscious sauerkraut. As a result, the Germans on the run are forced to retreat into the north hex. And that's the basic idea behind assaults. Next up is the command phase. In the command phase, you're going to determine your control over objectives and receive command and victory points. You'll also have an opportunity to spend those command points to determine initiative or activate strategy cards. So let's look at earning command. You earn command by having control of a hex with the command marker in it. Americans can only collect a command point per round from an American command marker, and the same with the Germans. Some scenarios also have neutral command areas that can be claimed by either side. Now, while the German player can't get a benefit from commanding the American command marker, he can prevent the Americans from getting their command points. Initiative points are important for two reasons. First, you can use them to gain the initiative by placing them on your initiative card. The player with the most initiative points on their initiative card gets the control of the initiative marker at the beginning of every round. Obviously, there's a tactical advantage to being able to shoot first. However, command points can also be used to activate strategy cards, and we'll cover off on those in just a moment. Strategy cards are drawn during the status phase. The status phase is also a cleanup phase where you prepare for the next round by removing markers, upgrading the round marker, checking your scenario if there's any reinforcement and events that happen, conduct any squad transfers, or decide to place units in op-fire mode. Tide of Iron comes with a number of strategy decks that can be utilized in various scenarios. There are specific strategy decks for countries, as well as more general strategy decks for either side. The scenario will tell you which strategy decks are used for that particular game. Let's take a closer look at one of these strategy cards. The important pieces of information are the name of the card, of course, the phase the card can be activated, the ability you're going to activate, and the cost, which is the number of command tokens to activate the card. You'll also notice a little plus on the left-hand side of the card. This is an additional bonus that means you get to draw one more card. This is a once per turn bonus, so if you draw another card with a plus sign, tough luck. Now there are several cards, in particular in the artillery and American air support decks, that have these mysterious instructions. I've deciphered how to interpret these cards in the path below. These are artillery and airstrike cards. So once you've paid your command points, you need to try to establish contact by rolling a six-sided dice. If you match or beat the number in parentheses, then you successfully make contact and you move to the next phase. If you fail the roll, you do not make contact and you need to wait until the next round to try again. Next, you will place a target marker on the board to where you want the strike to hit. Next, you will need to determine drift. So you're going to roll two dice, a red dice and a black dice. Success on the black dice depends on your line of sight to the target. If you have no line of sight, you must roll a 6. If you have line of sight, you need to roll a 4, 5, or 6. And if you have enhanced line of sight, you can roll a 3, 4, 5, or 6 to succeed. If you make the roll, then you move on to the next step. If not, then you've got drift. Look at the dice again, and that's the number of hexes that the shot drifted. Now look at the red dice and the drift marker. The number on the red dice tells you which direction the shot drifted. Now let's start calculating damage. Now some attacks do normal damage and some do suppressive damage. But the area attack number in parentheses tells you how many dice to roll to determine the damage. And if your card has wide blast radius, that means the surrounding adjacent hexes receive that many dice in attack damage. So let's see this in action. I've chosen the top priority barrage because I really want to see some fireworks. I need to roll a 4 to establish contact, and I roll a 5, so we're good there. I'm going to place my target marker on the bullseye on the field. I don't think I can roll a 6, so I'm going to send Major Johnson out to the field so I can have line of sight. I roll my 2 dice, and I roll a 3 and a 3. Oh, shit. Due to a slight calculation error, I have missed my shot, and the shot has drifted into an unfortunate accident with our line of sight officer. But perhaps he will survive the blast. It's only 5 dice, and as everyone knows, I suck at rolling dice. Oh, there's also wide blast radius. Anyway, let's have a briefing on Clash of Elites, the 4th game. Guest starring my new epic movie trailer voice. World War II, July 13th, 1944. The capture of Keraton is essential to consolidating the Utah and Omaha beachheads into a single defensible position. The 6th Fallsham Jaeger Regiment had evacuated the city on the 12th after running out of ammunition. Now, reinforced by the 17th SS Panzer Grenadiers, the German paratroopers have retaken part of the city. And it's up to the 502nd Parachute Infantry to clear them out again, house by house. Clash of Elites. Scenario designed by Craig Robertson. Objective. Americans win if they control the victory objective by round 4. The voice is still not working for you, is it? Oh well. Alright, let's set this bad boy up. In step 1, you're going to place boards 1A and 11A. In step 2, you're going to place the round track and the round marker. In step 3, you're going to place the command markers and the objective markers. In step 4, you're going to place the initiative cards and the initiative marker. In step 5, you're going to place the American and German squads. In step 6, you're going to place the game markers and the attack and defense dice. In step 7, you're going to place the specialization markers. So let's pause here and talk about specialization. There are a ton of different specializations that can be assigned to squads. I've outlined them here in this chart so you can get a quick idea of what each of them do. The Clash of Elites scenario requires you to use the Medic and the Flamethrower. The special abilities for the Medic is Bandage, which adds +1 cover. The second ability is Heal, so you roll 1 dice, and with a 4, 5, or 6 result, you can add 1 figure back to the squad base. The Flamethrower ability is really nasty. It gives you +2 firepower when you're adjacent to an enemy unit, and a -5 to that enemy's cover. So you can see how that could be a really dangerous squad. And as you can see, there are several other specializations that are used in other scenarios. So for example, I'm going to assign the Flamethrower specialization to Squad 5 on the American side. On the German side, I'm going to assign the Medic specialization to Squad 4. Now I'm going to leave you to play out this scenario on your own, and when you're ready, I'll show you what's required in the next game. Now that you got familiar with specialization, let's look at the 5th game. The 5th game is the same scenario, but with a step 8, and the step 8 is to place the strategy decks. The Clash of Elites scenario requires the Morale Deck 1 for the American side, and the Ground Support Deck 1 for the German side. However, for this scenario, you need to remove the go-to-ground cards, there's 2 of them, the take-down-the-beast card, there's 2 of those, and in the ground support deck, you need to remove the anti-air support, there's 2 of those, and the saboteur card, there's 1 of those. Now you're ready to play. So I'm going to now leave you to it. And that about wraps up Tide of Iron, Next Wave. Hopefully you've enjoyed this video and become more familiar with what can be a very challenging game. I'm Ben Harsh for Harsh Rules, and I'll see you next time.